So, let's get that map loaded up for you.
Oh.
No, I might do it from here, and then I'll see what that.
Maybe I'll just show you one here, so you'll know. You'll know.
Hey, Victor, sorry to call you on your cell phone, but I was away, and I just want to say it's a grass, and we can dig it up and move it to my house. Right, but I have to be around to show you where. Hey, did you ever hear back from Richie?
No.
Well, if you want to come over with him, I have the pump inside. Okay. I'm not going to be around tomorrow, so.
Yeah.
Well, call me when you come. Okay. You got it. Okay, good luck. Okay, bye.
Okay. Good afternoon. Welcome to the Shinnecock Nation Cultural Center Museum. We're so pleased to have you join us today for our final lecture series. This series is entitled Completing the Circle. And some of you, I think, we've seen previously at previous lectures. And those of you who are just joining us, we're happy to have you. Lisa Whale Nayak is my Indian name. That means yellow dove. I'm the administrative director here at the museum. And I'm happy to be here this afternoon presenting and moderating, actually, the presentation. We have some of our wonderful folks here who helped put on this event. Eileen Dugan, who's our educational coordinator. You saw her bright, shiny face as you walked in the door and she gave you some information. And just referencing a little bit of that information, there's a Did You Know piece and some frequently asked questions. Additionally, there is a vocab list, a Shinnecock language list, which is great because one of our presenters, both of our presenters will be talking about the language today, and so it's a nice reference tool. We also ask that if you have an opportunity before you leave, if you can fill out our cultural program survey. It really just helps us gauge how well we're doing or not, and how we can better our sessions, so I appreciate that. And then we have an upcoming event, our Strawberry Harvest Festival, and it's a lot of fun. We have wonderful vendors and presentations and dancers. We hope that by that time our Wegan Village will be at a backup and operational. It took a big hit from this harsh winter that we had, so we're really doing a lot of cleanup. And for those of you who would love to come out and learn and help us and volunteer cleaning up, we are going to be hosting some volunteer days and educational days where we'll be cleaning up the village, we'll be rebuilding some of the structures. I see one of our former employees sitting right here. Put him on the spot, but he's a great builder and a traditional crafts person, and I'm sure he'll be involved as well. And so, down for you, Terrence. And so we look forward to having you. If you'd like to see more and sign up at the gift shop, there is a sign-up sheet that talks a little bit about what happened and what our village is and how we'd like to bring it back to life again. Thank you. The indigenous language of the Shinnecock culture and our Wampum history are all interwoven. Today, we are completing the circle and ending the Wampum Lecture Series with presentations on Shinnecock language revitalization and preservation efforts. We have two presenters today. Here we have who have had unique experiences with Indigenous language, Roddy Smith, who's right here, who's recently been elected to the Board of Directors of the Shinnecock Nation Cultural Center Museum. So, I welcome Roddy again, who was also formerly a director of the museum and volunteer and is kind of coming full circle. Roddy is a Shinnecock tribal member. He has experience lecturing in schools and centers throughout the state. He's done presentations as far away as Brisbane, Australia. Roddy has also conducted nature walks and canoe tours, as well as overnight camps. He will share his research experiences and connections with the St. Francis Odonat First Nations Reserve in Quebec, Canada. I had the wonderful opportunity to work with Roddy when I was just a little wee intern back at the museum in the late 90s, and he and I trekked up to Alaska and all over the place and did some fun stuff and had some adventures and learning the language and doing research. So I'm excited to hear him take me back in time. Following a 5 to 10 minute break, we'll have Tina Tarrant, who's right here. She's also a Shinnecock tribal member who has a lifetime experience in cultural revitalization activities, traditional arts, music, and language. Today, she'll discuss her efforts in cultural renewal through the Shinnecock Language Revitalization Program. Tina is also a Thunderbird Sisters singer. The group, you may know the Nannies, the Native American music, same thing as awards, thank you. They are award-winning singing group and have, and we'll preview a little bit of their music after the break before Tina speaks. So you can hear a little bit of that. And I think we might have a singing opportunity in the shop, so you can check that out on our song time. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Tina and thank both of our presenters for coming today. And we'll have them come up and get started. Thank you. Excuse me. Yes, that would be Roddy. He's coming up.
Kwe, those are greetings in different dialects of the Algonquin language. Greetings from here, takes us in the far north, all the way up and off, we'll get to that later. I'll just put the point in for you. All the way up to this area here, so we're attached to all of this territory here. So we'll talk about this, we'll sing this here. Forward here. But what I'd like to do first is talk about my experience growing up in language. And for me, it really wasn't very much other. That's what we talk about in modernization, bringing back. And both my experience was very little. I can remember some words, being water, and words like that. But it wasn't, and what I was feeling then was, I would hear other languages of our territory, New York, or part of the North, here in Hawaii, it was totally different from our thing. Could be one day have that language come back to us. It was a thought, it was a dream, but I was studying back then, it was like, I didn't really didn't think that could happen. And so through, you know, throughout growing up, it was like that. But I do remember a few times as I got older, a tribal member came to me. And he says, he showed me this writing, this statement, where it said, well, you know what, let me back up a little bit. Even before I reached that point, we can talk off the road, before we even get into because growing up also, the stories of having your mouth washed out with some speaking language. So that was a way, that was assimilation. That was a way to not let us speak our language, not only here, but in other territories, even more recently, furthermore, especially Canada. And it's actually a movie title. And the sphere of things, and it talks about it, and it shows it. It's a way of assimilation. You don't speak the language, and anything, you won't follow anything that doesn't happen. But not only the baby people here, but also the indigenous people in Australia, also. There's a movie that we get to see too, it's called Dragon Pets. And what these do, it talks about the boarding schools. I don't know a lot about the boarding schools in our area. Further north, where it happened more recently, a lot of stories of boarding schools there. Actually, children were taken from their families and moved into the boarding schools. And it was punishment for keeping from speaking the language and for learning your culture or practicing your culture. That was the whole idea of assimilation. And so, without language, without culture, boarding, without land, those things happened more recently. All the areas. And just very quickly, I will mention, because I'll come back to the foreign laws of tribal culture later. They were able to hold on to that language, which is connected to us. They are relatives. They speak it every single day. That's the first language. See, they held on to it. This is one of the boarding schools there. This is, they were still following the parable. 50 years ago, they were still following the parable. So they had to take a couple of sins. I'll come back. I just wanted to mention to you that we have those things. But let me talk about where, for me, my experience with that language is starting to come back to me and start to listen to research. I'll go back and try to remember the pain to me. He says, Raj, you know, look at the statement here. There's a man who's a Mohegan preacher. His name is Samson Hopper. And he did speak to us here. But he wanted to form a university or college in Dartmouth area or in New Hampshire. And so he traveled there, and when he traveled there, the statement says, here he heard the language being spoken the same as that on Eastern Mahan. And that was pretty interesting. That you might need some things. So where is this place? So who are they speaking? So then I began researching try to figure out, okay, it's in Dartmouth. There's a language being spoken, similar, or not the same as ours here. So I did some research. And it led me to a language described as Western Aztec. And as I continued that research, okay, Western Aztec, what does that mean? And it seems as though this Western Abnaki seemed to be more of a refuge for people from this territory, moving away, displacing native people from that area, that language going with them. And so I continued to research that, okay, so this Western Abnaki in this area, where are they staying? Where are they living? I found out that it wasn't St. Francis over that area. Which is our point where I'm at. Guide you. So we're here, and it's probably about right in this area, right here. This is what I'm talking about. And so my journey began. I thought, well, let me take a journey of going back. Actually, it was my first reserve that I visited in Canada. This is going back from the early 90s, I guess it was late 80s. So I went into that territory, and I met an elder there. And, is Andre here?
Remember Cecile Wallenet?
Yeah. 2007. She was an elder there. And so I talked to her. And I told her where I was from. She says, well, in our way, we would say Sinipo, which is spelled Sinipo. I can remember. And I understand who later our next presenter from, which I'll tell you about sometimes the SNCCM, the pronunciations. But there she said, we say it Sinipo. And she said, didn't know where I was from or anything. And she said, you must be near some water. Some stones along the beach. Yes, that's where I'm from. Because Sine is a rock or stone. Rock, in a way, was land in reference to water. That's exactly where I'm from. And that's when I first found Shinnecock was broken down and along the way. You know, I never heard that before. So, of course, it's still out there somewhere. And so from there, continuing the research of Western Abenaki, and here's a book that came out during that time, too. Gordon Day, studying the area of studying the language of the area, pulling it together. And it was about Western Abenaki. And going through all this research and seeing that, the words, well, you will see some words are the same, some words are similar, and some words are completely different. And so now you can see this pattern of our language being spread all over the territory already, the outlaw language. Let me go back to that point to you again. And so we are here, and outlaw is all in this area here, all the way up in this territory. When it comes back in the Ojibwe territory, all that Algonquin island, different ways of saying different words, and some words being the same. And so I took this book, you know, by Gordon Day, was a man who looked at the language, began studying, and did the best I could with the language. I didn't have a lot of resources, and more resources. And as that interest grew, I decided, well, you know, I'm going to go back to home again. I'll make that journey because I came here and told you about that next journey is what I took myself and I went up there. And we took that journey back up there because we probably met the elder man. And she was actually giving classes. We went to those classes. And Andre picked up pretty quickly. Boy, she just picked it right up. Just picked it up. You know, and today, at the power of the sites, the Lord's praying, and she was praying, and she did a wonderful job. I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. She didn't do it. But obviously, she didn't do it. So, all that is doing is okay. So now, the interest is growing and growing. So my next journey took me a further distance away, and I'll show it to you here. So this is the Odnak area here, but I continue. I got the name of this place from a friend of mine from my travels. But from here, this is the St. Lawrence Seaway, and I traveled all along here. all along here to right about here, which is a place called Sakita, the French is called Sakita, St. Dogs. Then the road may continue a little bit, but it stops about right there. There are no roads all the way up to this territory here. There's a train that goes from here all the way up to this area right here. It's all bush territory here. Just one of you, if you want to go on a journey, you take that ride. It's about a 12 to 15 hour train ride. It's about 20 hours. So we're here. It's about 20 hours driving to this point. And we still have about another 12 to 15 hours to that point there. But that language there is described as Inu, and which means people. Most of us call ourselves people. Inu. Inuit, that's Eskimo, but it says people. And we go to Nen, people, so we call them speak for ourselves. It's the people. So that's Inu territory. Now, I'll give you a quick history of that so you can see where I'm going with all these things. In the territory, there are two different dialects, and they call one group Motanye. They call the other group Scat. Now, the Motanye, all this area here, and the Scatty, closer to the coast, and up in this area, closer to the inner territory. They have a settlement right there, or this Inu territory. And so, the different dialects there, with Inu, you have Montagne, and you have the Scat. Two different dialects, very, very, very close, very similar. And their word for water there, licking, the same as ours. Their word for rock there, shimmy. So, lower here, it's city, higher up, it's shimmy. So it's just changing very little that way. So, of course, with me, interest is growing and growing and learning and thinking, wow, think back when I started, did you ever bring, did you ever speak about them? Did you ever come back? You can't. It's happening. But how they protected their language in that territory? Well, it's, I do have to say, that there was an assimilation, the attempt at assimilation through the churches. And they tell me that story, you know, up there. They held on to the land, but in trying to pull it out, they call it there in the bush, surviving in the bush, falling down. My generation being born up there is still falling down in the territory. They traveled around the bush. So to them, ceremonies extremely important. Language, extremely important. To survive that harsh climate, you need those things to survive. Extremely harsh. You can imagine winters, minus 40 to minus 60, snow, you know, up to here, walking through, they call it the tiger territory. And then it's also subarctic, but it's further up than the trees. So it's really harsh climate. So, language, they had many, many different words for, let's say, water, because they go into descriptions. They describe how the water is. Many words for ice. They describe how the ice is. All the ice is describing the formation of the ice. Very, very descriptive how of their language came about. And that language being developed today, they use different, for instance, computer. They translate it into a way of using translating some thing you tap in the middle. Television, the box you stare at. So that's how I guess developing language. What's interesting is that what I'm finding that will compare to down here. Now these things are happening very recently. Very recently. So I'm thinking these are the type of things that have to happen in our territory. And so let's go back to the North there for a minute. And they were telling me, for instance, people from my generation looking at now, hardly understand their elders because of the natural change in the language. It just happens back in the places. There's a natural change. And being so isolated, you still saw that change. And he said, told me something that I didn't quite understand. And when you're in remote territory, but what I also found there, my last trip there, I was up there, I guess, maybe 2 years ago, way up in the territory. But they told me, a friend of mine mentioned this, she said, Brian, I'm getting a little worried about the language because the children. And I saw those changes through my trips up there. I guess I didn't personally was up there in 30 years about this one. But in that time, I saw the changes happening so quickly in that territory. But they said, language, you know, we're a little worried because the children, they'll speak the language, but sometimes they'll pronounce something a little differently. And the elders will say, no, not that way, this way. And they'll still say it the same way by that little mistake. And the elder would try frightened, oh, no, this way. And then the children would say, oh, you know what I mean. You know, almost getting, you know, maybe a little bit lazy, not really wanting to put that extra to keep it going in that way. And she was kind of, you know, kind of worried about that. And she says, I hope it doesn't mean, because that's something there. The children, their first language is Hebrew. It's a scat. Old time first language Hebrew, but their second language is French. So they speak Hebrew, Old time dialect, and French. Now, the Scaffy, this little community, right in here, speak Hebrew, not Master Scaffy dialect, but they speak English. So all this territory, all this French, English speaking voice right there. So what's interesting was one, you know, conversation I remember was he was a French native, and he only spoke French. He was only speaking French. And me, I can only speak English. So the French Canadian spoke French to the Montagnais. Because he could translate French into Montagnais, which is a Hebrew language. He could then translate that Montagnais dialect to the Scaffy, who had a second language in English. So you figure that was three different translations. So conversations were pretty long. You know, just in one place. But you know, I go up there and it's like they know now, the last time. Many know French, they know English, and they know two dialects of the Hebrew language. So that's basically four languages. It's so natural, like that, it's picked up. But again, when you're in a remote territory like that, it's easy to do because you do a lot of talking. It's so remote. You have plenty of time to talk about it. So you'll learn languages. And so I started picking up some language. I haven't done it in quite a while. But I started picking up some of that language there. And just coming back here, just knowing a little bit of our language here, and of course, this is how it's really, really, really picked up. And seeing the same things, seeing things in folks, seeing things. But as you can see, it actually goes over here, but it doesn't. So, I think what I'd like to do, have an idea. break out of the light. I had an idea of how close we are to what was in the territory, and the distance we had distance in. We traveled that distance. Before I go to this level, I can look at some of the other swords that traveled that distance. They told me that they would travel from this area here down to this place called Satil. It would take them months to go down here, but they would walk that distance, survive a long way. But there was an elder there. She told me that. She told me a lot of things. She only speaks Hebrew, no French, no English. Taught me four up arrows. So she would show us how to do that. One time, we'll see. Up there, that's survival. You have to survive over there. You're in the bush. That's how you survive. She told me those things. Again, through translation, she only spoke. I think what I'd like to do is I want you to listen to the CD. Let me explain to you. Well, just a song from it. Because I want you to hear different styles of songs and how they developed through the language. This particular CD here, it's a Cree called Tardane Scathing. It's called that song. Now, what was interesting is the original LP record of this, there was a letter in it. And this letter was from the, see, there were miners that went in there, and the trappers that went into it. And so, this is from a miner. And he wrote this verse saying that he had come across natives in the bush there, surviving in the bush. He wrote this letter. And in this letter, it just described the people that were there because they didn't know they were there, scattered throughout the bush. That's how he survived. But in this letter, talking about the people, and then there was an elder there that was interviewed. And this elder, he soon knew some of the hunting songs. They had hunting songs, they had dream songs. And again, hearing that, I come back to here and say, wow, that's probably part of us too. You know, these are the things that are slowly coming back. And they will come back. But you'll see our name is from. So they would have these hunting songs. Now these hunting songs, some songs they can sing to others, you know, to the public. But some of these songs they would keep them to themselves. Because dreams were extremely important. They would dream, and the song would come to them in the dream, and they know the parable, they know the demon, they know where the body is at. How else even survive? So when you're close to nature in that way, when you're close to these songs, it's a survival thing. You must do it. And that's what they do. These dreams would come to them, and when you go to the ceremonies, they have another shape of the head. It's another way of hunting in the bush, following, not getting lost in the bush. But what was interesting is when I found out about this recording, the man that sang the songs was the grandfather of a best friend of mine in New York. He met him up there. He's the one that stayed at his home. He showed me, talked all these things. Come find out his grandfather. He's the one singing the songs on him. And then he was like, wow, just the connections, all these connections. So he just kept connecting, connecting. Of course, we've been down here sharing stories with us. But could you, it's that CD, we'll just play the one song, and when you hear it, you will hear some of the words, you will hear the language. And the drum head. Can you turn it up just a little bit?
I want it,
Is that as high as it goes?
Okay. I wanted you to hear that. If you can understand when he spoke English at the end, he said, he didn't make that song. He dreamed that. And what he wanted to explain is that in the old way, living in the bush with no house, those dreams would come from that way, which is closer to nature. But when he moved into the house, he dreamed no more about the way. Being close to that nation, living in that way, you come close to these things, and become very important. Ceremonies were based on that. Songs were based on that. Dances were based on that. And so since we were so similar, I know many of those things are similar to here. And of course we're all close, but many things that we were taught here. In the time, that'll come back to us too. So that was back in this recording was back in the 1960s. But what has happened today, they have a new style of singing, using their language, but it's more of a country folk type of song. And the songs are really pretty, really nice, like the same kind of song. Like you have someone who sings these pretty songs. I do have it on here. I'll just play it on here, just so you can get an idea of what it sounds like. You hear the guitar and you hear the different types of music, and then I'm going to tell you about the festival. But these are just the changes that have happened.
Okay, I just wanted to show you that sample. You see the changes about what they're singing. They are singing out long in that style of song. And what they also have today, it's a festival called Inu Nipamu, which means, loosely translated, Indian music. And it takes place around this territory right here. Maliotanam is the name of the reserve there. And so they come from all of the areas there, and they have the Inuit folk singers, so they come to that area to perform. But it's a festival, probably about 4 days. But see, you can see the development and how strong the language is still there. And that's part of what we're doing here to revive all of that, because we want strong like that. I think what I'm going to do is I want to read to you a few actual statements or actually some sayings that different people have said about language, how important language is. Language is one of the fundamental aspects of a person's worldview and self-identity. The secrets of our culture lie hidden within our language. That's written by someone like Joseph. It is their language that allows, now this is written in 1895, the annual report from the Department of Indian Affairs. It is their language that allows them to form a people apart. As long as they preserve their language, they will be impossible to assimilate. Another sample. Language is not only a vehicle for the expression of thoughts, perceptions, sentiments, and values characteristic of the community, it also represents a fundamental expression of social identity. A common speech serves as a peculiar potent symbol of the social solidarity of those who speak the language. In short, language retention helps maintain feelings of cultural kinship. So, language is who you are, how you feel, to think in your language, to dream in your language, to live every day in that language. In the north, where it's still their first language, it's pretty cool. They tell these kids in school, teachers are reading French and English, don't know what they're saying, and it's, have a good time in the language. But they were able to hold on to it because they're pretty scattered. A little lower there, if you have a chance to see where the spirit lives, you will see that develop. But in the higher side, you come into the village and trick the children into getting on the plane. They would get on the plane and take off and go to boarding school and try to assimilate. That was, just trying to break that closeness. With that, I think what I'll do, so that's kind of the background of what I said before. Could it ever come back? Could we ever have a revival? And going through this research, and then others picking up on that, and you will hear how far we've come with that language. And so with that, I will say, that would be Big Wetch, Jewish school again.
Thank you, Ray. I think with that, we'll open it up to some questions, if you'd like to do that, since we have a little time.
Okay. So, you say the name of the place that I believe is in New Brunswick. So that we have that on our recording. What is your name?
Oh, it's actually in Quebec. Quebec, yeah. Oh, yeah. Western Avenue. Yes.
What
Right, to also say the name of where the festival is, and then say that on the tape, and so I can spell it in my writing. And also, my other question will be, we've sometimes heard that Moravian Town, which is just across from Detroit, had the people there spoke a very, very similar dialect to what our people were here. Did on the map there, did that same movement go that far, or was that a separate and independent placement of the language?
I haven't gone that far in the research, but what I've gotten so far, I think it's very similar. You know what I'm thinking? Because they're more... They're more over in this area.
Moravian Town is right by Detroit. Right across. Yes. Yeah.
Well, there's another settlement right over here too in Ontario.
Mm-hmm.
The two of those are connected.
Mm-hmm.
But from my research, very, very similar.
Mm-hmm.
Again, similar in all these territories. So there was a movement, you know. There was the the migration pattern.
Mm-hmm.
And it just seems though many in this area wound up and spoke in that territory. I guess a refuge for displacement. You can see it happen though over many areas over than it happened. But yes, as research continues, it will be more. It'll be more.
But tell us again the name of that town where the festival took place.
Oh, okay, that's not pointed out to you. Festival? It's near a city up here called Satil, translated to Seven Islands, and reserve is Malyotonam. And it's all right within this area. And people from all of this bush area, they will travel down to Inunitmoon. And that has changed too. There is more of the type of music that I just played for you, more of the modern type of music. Less of the traditional music. Before, the traditional music was a hand drum. And you heard on that that CD, you heard like a rattle. It's a hand drum. And on the back of it are pieces of bone. You see, so when you hit it, it rattles in the back. You heard that rattle on the drum. They did more of that. Now they're doing less of that and doing more of the a modern country style singing. That was brought about by a group called Cash In. They were the first ones to do that, and I think that was back in probably in the early 90s, I guess it was. It started that in Malyotonam, and then it just traveled through different areas and became very, very popular. So today, more of that is sung than that festival than the traditional band style.
Was the Algonquin language, was that spoken by the Iroquois Nation?
It was a different type of language. It's I guess when you go through the linguistics and you broke it down, they're not similar to the Iroquois. It's more similar to the, we'll name a few, like here in Mohegan, Narragansett, Wampum, Penobscot, Passamaquoddy. Creed, going over to this territory over here, as well as the Igbo and the Scapa, more similar to that. Because breaking down the language, but it's interesting because, you know, Iroquois. In this territory here, we're right here, we get our language is similar to
Have these dialects been written down, and over time, do you have enough elders left that it's there are written records any place of all these dialects?
Glad you mentioned that because I have a dictionary here, and if you have a chance, take a look at it because. They have, characters, and they represent different sounds of
the alphabet, and you can see from this dictionary here. And this is mainly Miskapi, again very similar to our territory, Innu, Nepal. But they do have characters here. And when you have a chance, look at this and you see the characters that are spoken down. Now, see, this dictionary was put together in a way, because it's not a word-to-word type of thing. Phrases, again, for instance, as I explained before, different words for water because of the way, ice, and then different types of ice, wind, direction of the wind, how strong, all these details fit within the language. So, you know, let me give an example.
Is there one for the Shinnecock language?
No, not so much my knowledge. No.
Don't have anything.
Let me just pick water. Just so you can see the many different ways they explain water.
And I think Tina might also talk a little bit about some of the documentation over time. There is some documentation of our language.
So, I mean, it goes down to, you know, details like he or she makes the water move. On this side, the near side of a lake, body of water. Just describing all of this. Across water. So it's not just water, and everything is like that. Like I mentioned before, snow, a description of snow. Even rain, a description of rain. Everything is very descriptive. So when you do this, when they did this dictionary, it was put together that way. Many phrases that were used. That's just more.
Okay, so we'll just take a short 5-10 minute break, and we invite everyone to walk around, take a look at some of the exhibits if you haven't had enough.
Yeah, all the notes for today, because I don't want it to go off in one direction and not go back to point. So I am starting with the idea of reclaiming our language, the language of our people. Every culture has history, every culture has beliefs and values, every culture has art and language. Within a society, all of these aspects are intertwined and used together. Wampum is an example of this interconnectedness as art and as a medium of communication. There's always a backstory and a history attached to where the materials come from and what methods and tools are used to create each type of wampum bead or other shape. The use of color, pattern, symbols, the size of beads, whether they're loose or strong or woven, how a wampum belt is finished, with closely knotted ends or with loose hanging wood. They're all intentional choices. These things all carry meaning and reasons why they were built a certain way. When asked about wampum belt breeding, I heard traditional friend of ours. He explained after being in ceremonies when he read the notes, said that every bead has words associated with it. Either the words remind you of something, or the words are there, and someone may come along someday and know what the words of that bead are. So in an oral society, many things hold concepts and information in ways that are not apparent to those who are not brought up in the setting or that would otherwise be obvious. Our language is not a written language, it was spoken. Our words carry with them concepts that are linked to our surroundings and beliefs. Travel and communication is a regular part of life on this continent for thousands of years. The network of waterways are well known and well traveled. All these travel principles help us. We're coastal people and traveled waterways. It's easy to walk in. So there's connections and links between many, many communities. All the concerns and action. This one shows the area where Algonquin languages were spoken. Like the area used to be a lot larger, but it does show that it extends well across the continent. There are Algonquin speaking tribes who tell stories of how they used to live on the East Coast, and over time they traveled west, and it's part of their history, part of their language, stories. And there's also other tribes that used to be Sudan speaking tribes along the East Coast. And they tell stories of having a voice. I know a little while that we know from here that we've heard a similar version of it from the Dakota country. So there's tribes also traveled from the south, and over many years they came to live in the northeast, bringing with them their languages and their ways. When these migrations occur, newer understandings develop, learning from each other and adapting to new environments, physically and socially. And the stories of these travels became part of the history of everyone involved. So that's that gap area that you see, you know, the water right there, is an improvement Wampum area. Right in the center of that territory is Lhasa people are still there. And they're Algonquin. They're all Algonquins. Prior to the Rapala Iroquois. So they moved right into an area that already had a Wampum connection and culture happening. And I think it's interesting and something I need to ask why the Iroquois still call Wampum Wampum, because that's the Algonquin term. Of course they know how to say shell, they know how to say bead in their languages, but it's important that they keep that connection. I'd like to know more about that. So this map shows some of the names. The categories. So the Iroquois, Sumerian, Algonquian, our own names have been assigned to our languages to categorize them. In the past, academic language studies didn't always include the oral histories of Native people themselves regarding language. The Shinnecock language is classified as an Algonquian language dialect. There are many dialects in this language, and they're all closely related, but there is a variety of similarities as well as differences. There are differences in pronunciation, phrases and words related to local areas, the plants and animals, the weather conditions and geography. Also find that some communities who speak the same dialect speak differently. Slower, faster, drop beginnings of words, you drop ends of words, just there's variety. But it is understandable. These maps show an area where we are and some of our neighboring tribes. Again, lines drawn on the map to show the divisions of one community. Of different dialect areas. But again, we know that people travel and were able to communicate with each other. Prior to the permanent arrival of the English on Eastern Long Island in 1601, individual people had been exposed to English and other European languages. They were already Dutch, French, Spanish, and English settlements along the eastern shores of North and South America. There were established travel routes which Europeans had been using for years across the Atlantic Ocean. So the Shinnecock people, the coastal people, had long been aware of news and encounters with strangers from across the world. Although no one from Shinnecock in June of 1648 was still in English, they did know where they were coming from, and they were welcome. And now this year, they're celebrating 375 years of being here on the island. And when they came, they brought their language, their religion, and their outlook on their place and position in this part of the world. And over 100 years later, the English language had gained much popularity in Shinnecock. Because it was in 1749 when Samson Wampum had come to live on Long Island, and he was living at Montauk, and he began teaching English classes to the Montauk and Shinnecock students. It slowly the native people of Long Island began making the shift to using the English language. And my mother was a child, and she didn't know things. And she remembers that they would say things that she had. So they didn't call her Elizabeth, they called her Sydney. Like the light and dark colors of the frog shell, Wampum and Sydney, the light and dark. She was their first grandchild, and she was precious to me. Of course, her father heard the sound of language when he was here, too, and his parents and grandparents knew a lot more of the language, but still, they only spoke English for me. Our language is still not spoken fluently, but it hasn't entirely disappeared. It's just listening. Yeah, so we're all familiar with what Chinook words look like and sound like. We use them all the time. Using our words is what keeps language in. So slowly, we're bringing back our language. It left slowly. And it's coming back slowly. But we're taking these baby steps, building a foundation for bringing our language back into use. About 40 years ago, some Shinnecock people began giving their children names in our language. The name that went on the birth certificate. And now, many of our children and grandchildren and even great-grandchildren have Shinnecock names. And each of these children carry a piece of the language which they and their families and their friends and their school teachers learn. And not only are words in our language being spoken and understood, our vocabulary is grown. There have always been Shinnecock people who have worked to continue to keep the cultural traditions active by participating in sharing this knowledge in the community. June meeting, number one, powwows and other events depended on community involvement and focus on culture. And these gatherings date back to times when people traveled freely to different communities on Long Island and across the Sound to take part in annual ceremonies. But some of the names used for these events have gone through changes over the years since the 1640s. We've done the Minipo, became June meeting in the 1800s when Reverend Paul Puffy, who was a Shinnecock minister, reintroduced our spring Thanksgiving, the strawberry feast, as a church event. Our fall Thanksgiving is beginning to be called Nunawa again. And powwow is still powwow. There wasn't an alternate term for that because powwows are against the law. So, that's what we're spoken about. But, okay, so the word powwow, in our language, it means a spiritual meeting. And if you look it up, it's one of the words that are documented. But the translation is a conjurer or sorcerer. So that's why that sort of gathering wasn't spoken in the. And now a word powers is all over the country by all different tribes. And on Shinnecock this year, we're celebrating the 69th annual Labor Day weekend power. Reservation of Cowgrounds. The first Shinnecock Labor Day weekend powwow was in 1946 in my grandfather's front yard. It had come to him that it was necessary for our people to do something together. It would help us keep our culture and tradition strong. And that it was important for our people to remember our ways and for the children and the next generations to continue feeling confident in who they are as Shinnecock people. another cultural group that came into existence in 1972 was called SNAC, the Shinnecock Native American Cultural Coalition. And that gave the young people opportunity and inspiration to focus and learn about their culture and have activities and events throughout the year, not just waiting for the annual celebrations. And over the years, there have been many cultural enrichment programs that include reveal making, singing, dancing, beaver, gardening, and cooking. So what we needed to work on next was bringing a language out of the shadows. So there was a focused effort by the Shinnecock Museum, and in 1993, I worked on that with my cousin. Our goal at that point was to identify and gather as many of these resource materials relating to Eastern Algonquin languages as we could, and utilize the resources to develop vocabulary lists or words and phrases. We created audio tapes of the Lord's Prayer and the Apostles' Creed with written translations in English and Algonquin. They were used in the Shinnecock Sunday School. There was also a video demonstration of Shinnecock students in conversation and a dialogue piece used originally by the Okotok language class. Because during that time, over at Kuskatuk, they were holding culture classes, and language was part of that curriculum. So we worked together on that, shared materials, we discussed similarities and differences, and gaps in our collections. Gaining access to resources from the outside of our own community, has always been one of the hardest challenges. For example, the Indian Bible that they have a copy on display in East Hampton for decades. They've always kept it under glass, and we never had access to a book inside or a page. Well, we got around that because that was a given. In 1987, my sister had gone to Scotland on a church-related event. But she came home with a copy of the Bible on microfilm from the University of Edinburgh. So we had that to work with at the time of the museum language project. It was still on film, so her project was having it printed out so that we could all access it and look at it. The Indian Bible was the first Bible ever printed in North America in 1663. The microfilm reel that we had, it was labeled as the entire Bible, but what it actually was when it printed out was the 1661 version, and it also had a printout of Eliot's grammar book. So the Bible was the outcome of years of work with language study translation by Reverend John Eliot, whose name appears as the translator. But many native speakers from many tribal communities were involved in that process of translating, editing, and printing. So that's why so many Southern New England tribes refer to the language of the Bible as their own, because it is. Kapanunda Long Island, he's been referred to as Eliot's first translator and teacher of the language. He was a teenager, and one of the few native people from Long Island who did understand English. And while he was visiting in Connecticut, he had been taken prisoner by an English soldier in the aftermath of the massacre of Pequots, at least, in 1637. Then he was eventually sold to Reverend Elliot in Massachusetts. So while Elliot was teaching Coppenhoek to read and write in English, Coppenhoek taught Elliot about the structure of the Algonquin language. Years later, Coppenhoek was able to return to Long Island when he married Quashnong, who was the sister of Nomadama, who lived on Shinnecock. Nomadama was Sachin at Shinnecock, and Quashnong was Sunkspot. So while I was checking up my notes, I decided to look online and see if access to that Bible in East Hampton would be any easier these days. Maybe they had digital Bibles or something. Well, I couldn't find any mention of the Bible on the library's website. So as I was flipping out there, I saw a news item, and it was an article announcing that it had been sold at auction last year for a record-breaking high price of around $300,000. So, good thing we didn't hold our breath. Well, since the Museum Language Project in the 90s, we've worked toward other venues for collaborating on language revitalization. In 2009 and 10, people from Okeechobee, Shinnecock, Montauk all came together to work with SUNY Stonebrook at Southampton. And the Algonquin Language Reformation Initiative was formed. An agreement of cooperation was all worked up, and it was between the Okeechobee Nation, Shinnecock Nation, Montaukit Nation, the New York Botanical Garden, and State University of New York and Stony Brook. And plans were in place, everybody was ready for the Festival of D.C. event day, and invitations all ready to go when Southampton campus shut down, and everything that was there. So, everyone who was involved with that is still interested. So stay tuned. What did come out of that event, that endeavor, was a new opportunity for all of us. It was a connection with the New York Botanical Garden in regard to ethnobotany. The plant names and the things that are local to us here, that's all part of the language curriculum and something that everybody's looking forward to having more time to do with community gardens and making it accessible to our kids to have hands-on experiences the most they can. Also in that SUNY project, Stephanie Galen from Mohegan, she does head up their language department, and she has put together their dictionary. And she invited all of us who were in that group to take part in their language classes that they do, study for webinar. Anyway, it was over the internet. So we had to keep moving from room to room in college. Each week, a little more of the college was shut down. So pretty soon, we're almost in our closet using their internet system so we could go to this language class. And it was very interesting. Their language is so close to ours. And we learned a lot, and it made us recognize more of the connections of what we do know, what we have heard, and reaffirming to be on a good track and knowing that we can get there too. The Shinnecock Culture Nurture Program did this is about one of their programs, is the language project. And there was a room dedicated over in the preservation building. And a computer system was installed, and shelves put up for resources. And we actually started holding classes in 2011. And that was the year that the summer camp for the kids on the reservation was focused on culture. So they called it the culture camp. And they had language lessons one or 2 days during the week. They would go on nature walks with different people who would show them places and names and get them familiar with where we are, where we come from. They would have field trips up to the museum and take different tours and focus on different ideas and things over here. And it was really good. It's hard to keep programs like that year after year, but it's so important when we can. Oh, I had to know about the Northwest Paladins, because that was an opportunity where the young people from here, who took part, they were able to do their part verbally in their own language. And it was the first year, I guess they weren't skipping through any bullets the first year, so they didn't have to say anything. But the next two times, 2 years. My son and my daughter went. And they were able to introduce themselves and say where they're from and ask permission to land on the shore and get to ask permission to leave as well. And also stuck in a word for them. I'm sorry. They said they had mistakes. At the protocol at the end, after each stop at each different community along the way, weeks of traveling. There's a non-stop welcome that goes on for days on end. And whoever had traveled the furthest to be with presents from their community and their songs and their dances and their gifts. So Roddy had gone out and met the kids those last 3 years. Yeah. See, and he couldn't spend the whole time on the journey with them, but he was there to help them present a cup when they got there. And they did their songs and dances, and it was just a fulfilling experience for him. So there's many types of resources that pertain to the topic one that's spanning hundreds of years. There's first-hand knowledge from our friends and relatives and things that have been passed down. A lot of them are, you know, common knowledge that we all know how to name, we all know the type of name, even if we pronounce it differently. Then there are the historic published word lists, like Lion Gardner's word list, Josiah Cotton's word list, Thomas Jefferson. I guess we're going to mention variations on similar things in the next part. There's also language studies by linguists and scholars who study the language. We try to list out materials, some materials that we had working. There's so many different kinds, and they talk about different aspects and different things. A lot of them are debates about what they think about us. So those are one category of information that is important, but it's not helpful to teaching the kids language. They need to know positive things. This one says the beans of all Ireland seem to have been less troublesome to the whites than those north of the south. I wouldn't show that to anybody. But it does have a list of numbers and words and translations. So picking through what written materials there are going for is a whole category into itself. The way that the work lists were collected from native speakers and documented by either English or French or Dutch or German-speaking researchers, it adds a level of diversity to how they speak things. And the choice of which native word was used to represent the equivalent English word listed was not always clearly. For example, the word brother might have one word assigned to that ministry on the work list and leaving out any details about what it means. And on one list, and might have, well, it says you're old brother. And then next to it is another word, which was on the same parallel comparing words for brother. Now, it also does mean brother, but that's only the way a man would say it. And the last one, my brother or sister, depending on if it was the opposite of who was speaking. So, little details are included in a list of this means that and this means that. So that's the kind of thing that we have to sort out for the kids and just tell them which one to use in the first place and not have to go through all the backtracking. So, the choices, the letters that you use, the structure of the words, and using language and context is the kind of resource material that I prefer to work with because it shows the grammar in use. It doesn't explain it very well, but it is interesting. You can learn a lot of different things about these three versions of the first page of the book of Genesis. In the first one, created the heavens and the earth. And then there's an English translation above the words, and it says heaven as a singular word. But the form in Shinnecock is very different if it's pluralized. And it's pluralized in an animate way. And then down in verse 8 doesn't show. It uses heavens as plural again, but this time it's represented as an inanimate plural form of the word. So, it's hard to imagine being taught that you have to learn this religion and abide by it and have full faith in it. And it was very confusing. But, all those little aspects, in the long run, have served as an example for us to learn from. A whole new category of information. Oh, this is a page from Elliot's grammar. His English grammar terminology is really different from modern day. So I never got real familiar with the English terminology. And when I got hold of this, I learned it. So it makes sense to me. But I need to teach what I know to a teacher who will, in turn, pass it on so that others can learn from it. And it's really important. So the two types of language classes and lessons that we need to do are for teaching and developing learning tools. And in those, in that setting, then we go into how sounds, the sounds of words are produced, categories of word structures, how phrases and sentences are formed, cultural significance in words, songs, and stories, and standardized spelling, and perhaps another writing system, eventually. And this background area of research and study for pulling together information on the structure of language and developing literature in and about our language. That's where we look forward to working with our young Shinnecock linguists, who are training, and Sarah's graduated from her Starless training, to do those types of linguistic tasks. And you have to be trained to do that. But you have to have materials to work with so that they can do their part of that. And so it's just a matter of time when we'll get it together. The other type of classes are for teaching language to students. And then we have to prepare categories of vocabulary words, which is the sort of sentence-building words that we would be using. Spelling, not so much. We have to wait for the sentence. So in the meantime, well, we do hold classes. Okay, so they're laid out. The format of classes is to be intergenerational, because so often people can't come out after work or after school without bringing the rest of the family or babies or whatever it takes to get there. So, they're welcomed, and there's place and part for everyone in a class. So historical cultural background relating to words, and they're all open for discussion and input, because I think that classes should be for learning, and participating is a big part of it. And using different tools that we've been doing, so either having actual items we're talking about, or and combining that with American Sign Language, because that's something they offer in South Africa High School, and a lot of the Shinnecock students take that class, and this gives them a good reason to practice, and it's a way of helping you remember how to say your words. So putting different levels to make it easier to learn. And all the activities are group activities. And it's most fun if it's a game and everybody plays a game. And you have to have food. It's around dinner time. At the end of our language classes, the last time we did it, we organized for an immersion meal for the final day. So I brought in the food, and there was no English speaking. And it was fun. We said a lot of silly things, but it was fun. And we had a chance to get our friends out.
And this should be last year?
It was 2 years ago. Yeah. I think that's the first last time. Yeah. It's so hard to get people available at the same time. Mm-hmm. And if you can come a couple of times, that's great. But when someone starts at fourth class, they need to start at the beginning. So we start again. So pretty soon, you know, everybody's catching up with each other, and everyone is supportive, so we can help each other. So it goes faster each time. the last round of classes, I have all set up for to do a series like that. We have the different parts of the language it focuses on and different types of information about it. And each week a different thing. And then the review. But only a bunch of little kids came out. Take that out, and we got out the tic-tac-toe, and we did it north and south, and this way and that way. So whatever way people are comfortable doing things, just start doing it with our own words. And then it's not a separate, scary thing to learn about. And I say, I don't want anybody to be afraid of learning a language, or be ashamed of not knowing it. Can't know it unless you learn it. So, my goal is to have everybody come out and do something that helps make it a positive experience for each other. We had classes here at the Weaver Village the year that the staff was training. They had to learn how to do everything. And then they had to learn how to talk about it. So they were fun people. Because we played games. We had basket games, the stones. They liked to play Uno. So we made up the words on the Uno cards and Xeroxed it all together. So. Those are the silly parts. They actually learned all the cultural information that they were supposed to learn too. And we did some camp. Okay, there's a preschool on the reservation that's about to open up. And next week, I'm supposed to spend 3 days there with the staff, the teaching staff, and going over all the words that we're going to have in place. So as these kids come up, they're going to say them. They're going to know them. They can't read, so it doesn't matter how to spell them. The point is to learn it, not to memorize stuff. It's to understand. Are there any other questions?
So, Tina, what does Nichimon Shinnecock preschool, what does Nichimon mean?
Well, Nichimon is the children of the children. So it's the children of Shinnecock. It says the Shinnecock is the people of the stolen shore.
What do you envision would be like your first lessons with the little ones?
Whoever shows up at training this week.
But what words would you start out with?
The hellos and byes, the mommies, and happy, and numbers. Because all the games do numbers and all colors. Just the basics, but as well as, okay, so I had to make up a word for the refrigerator. Because you got to look in the fridge. So, Adjokad is the place where it stays cold. We haven't said that in Shinnecock.
Could you give us a short copy?
About numbers.
I do numbers. For someone who loves language, I don't like speaking. So numbers, say it with me. Mish, mish, yal,
yal,
lapana,
lapana,
masasa,
masasa,
shwasa,
shwasa,
paskubin,
paskubin.
questions again? So at the after school program, they've been having, I think Josephine had been going over there all through their program last year. So this kid's will count to 10 and then count backwards. And then they play games of counting. And that's for playing games. You get comfortable with the information. Yes.
That's again more necessary for safety. Just when you were counting a lot of those numbers, it's coming to like remember those numbers, so it's just very simple.
My mom's still working at the museum since the start, and I don't know if David decided the title of the village. Andrea decided the title of the village. So my mom had just seen it spelled out so many times, it didn't connect until she heard somebody else talking about it, saying, "We've been. Oh, that's ours." So, our language has surrounded us for generations, and it's still here, and we just need to learn to recognize it.
So, Tina, you just always speak so inspiringly of the project. It's true. I mean, she says Wigwam. Now, you see the K. Some people want to say K, but we come to know that that K is a G. And sometimes the T is a D. And the, you know, my name, it's a PB together, you know?
Right,
so
okay.
We get those sounds and you get familiar with those. But I walked into the Early Learning Center the other day and they've got, the rooms have names. So there's
okay.
Yeah, so they already have the names posted there, the names of the different rooms. There's the day and the night and the, you know, the water room, you know, the nippy room and the, you know, and it's all there. So, what really hit me was our kids are going to see that from the beginning, but our adults, we're not familiar with speaking every day that way. But now we are seeing our words there just in front of us every day. So our adults are also going to be more familiar, you know, because it's going to take some time. Sarah, they mentioned a young lady who graduated from Columbia last year. She just got accepted to a 5-year PhD program at Berkeley. And, yeah, she's in. Okay. So she's leaving in 2 weeks for Berkeley. But it's going to take some time. You know, it's going to take 5 years before she's got that PhD, before she's a big deal linguist.
Well, how many little books would you be able to help her?
That's exactly right, you know. And she's going to do it in 2 languages because her dad's language, Rupa, or what is it?
Huh?
Europe? No, they're Rupa. I'm trying to remember how they really say their, Rani, you may remember, how they say their tribal language, whatever it is.
Yeah
it's not Rupa, but whatever it is, they have a language. So she'll be doing the 2 languages. She'll be doing the Eastern Algonquin, and she'll be doing that with her boyfriend, Cheyenne. She'll be the linguist. But then we've got Sky at Stony Brook. Again, Stony Brook, really, even though they've abandoned this campus until we make them unabandon it, there's something in the wind. But they have, you know, they have committed to continuing the Algonquin language revitalization or restoration work. And we've got at least one person there now who's, you know, a brilliant language scholar, starting out in Southampton High with American Sign Language, picking up several other languages. And now as she's picked up several others, Sky Wagner, you know, as she's picked that up, now she's also embracing the Algonquin language as well, so she'll be a very fluent speaker in many languages, but also a very knowledgeable person about language structure and language teaching and use. So it's there. We just need you know, our internal support, we need to support one another, and we need the external support and encouragement that this can happen through the schools. These are languages that have meaning and must be supported.
I think that Tina put it best by saying it's just resting. You know, our language is just resting, and it's awakening gradually into the efforts of Tina and Roddy and all the people here in Shinnecock who are, you know, committed to doing this and seeing this part of our culture come back to life. It's just a perfect description. Well, thank you so much, Tina, Roddy, for the wonderful information that you shared, and I think that we all can walk away with a little more appreciation about this community and the dynamics of our language and our language retention and our revitalization efforts. I just wanted to do a little housekeeping. Those of you who have not filled in your form, to just give us some feedback about how you like this session, what you think we could do to make it better. Please fill that out. And Eileen, as she smiled you in, she will smile you out and graciously collect those forms for you. And so we thank you. And if you're around on June 14th, thank you, for the Strawberry Festival, you'll have an opportunity to come back and learn more about who we are. So we welcome you and we thank you again. And thank you for all the people who have made this event and this lecture series possible. This was funded through the Babylon Citizens Arts Council, through Suffolk County Cultural Affairs, and we're grateful for the funding to be able to provide this to the public for free, and also to the hard work and dedication of volunteers like Matt Ballard here, who's our expert techie and extraordinaire of all. He just helped install the kitchen and do other things, so he's not confined to that. And to our wonderful staff, Eileen Dugan, education coordinator, our museum gift shop staff, and our board supporters and volunteers and board members, newest board member Ronnie Smith, and our vice president here, Elizabeth Hale, and around the corner, the two lovely ladies that you saw there were Becky Valdez and Cheryl Terry, who are both board members as well. So thank you all again, and we had a wonderful time with you, and we thank you for your support and look forward to continuing to see you in the future. Thank you. Have a good night. Thank you.